church that's with you, or the Messiah House. It'll be fixed by next week. Sorry, I can't get the plumber after I discovered that this morning. Okay, we're going to go back to that. We'll continue with confession and absolution. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who looks upon us in compassion, forgives our sin, and heals our lives.
Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, creator of the stars at night, companion at the evening table, breath over the deep waters.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy and gracious God, we confess that we have sinned against you this day. Some of our sin we know, the thoughts and words and deeds of which we are ashamed. But some of us know nothing to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask forgiveness. Deliver and restore us, that we may rest in peace. Amen. Please rise and face the baptism. As tender as parent to child, so deep is God's compassion for you. As high as heaven is above earth, so vast is God's love for you. As far as east is from west, so far God removes your sin from you, renewing your life through Jesus Christ. Blessed be God, who crowns us with mercy and love. Blessed be God forever. You may be seated.
Israel, give heed to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to observe, so that you may live to enter and occupy the land that the Lord, the God of your ancestors, gave you. You must neither add anything to what I command you, nor take away anything from it, but keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I am charging you. You must observe them diligently, for this will show your wisdom and discernment to the peoples, who, when they hear all these statutes, will say, surely this great nation is a wise and discerning people. For what other great nation has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is whenever we call to him? And what other great nation has statutes and ordinances as just as this entire law that I am setting before you today? But take care and watch yourselves closely, so as neither to forget the things that your eyes have seen, nor to let them slip from your mind all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and your children's children. The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation of shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my love. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. For your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourselves of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror, or they look at themselves and, on going away, immediately forget that they are right. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing, if anything they are religious, and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel affirmation. Together we speak, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 7th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For Pharisees and all Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about the hypocrites, as it is written, 'The people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines.' You abandon the commandment of God and hold the human tradition," he said to them. "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to keep your tradition. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die. But you say that if anyone tells father or mother, 'Whatever support you might have had from me is korban,' that is, an offering to God, then you no longer permit doing anything for a father or mother, thus making void the word of God through your tradition that you have handed on. And you do many things like this." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile." When he had left, the crowd entered the house. His disciples asked him about the parable. He said to them, "Then you also fail to understand? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile, since it enters not the heart, but the stomach, and goes out into the sewer? Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, 'It is what comes out of a person that defiles. For it is from within the human heart that evil intentions come, fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. And all these things come from within, and they defile a person.' This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you, Lord. You may be seated."
Please join me in prayer. May the words of my mouth, may the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today's texts are begging for a salad theology sermon. You know salad theology? Let us do this, let us do that, let us do this, let us do that. The Old Testament, the song, "Who may abide on the holy hill? Who may enter tabernacle?" Well, let us lead a blameless life. We know what is right, then we can do that. Let us speak the truth from our heart, and then we can do that. That's how we gain access. Or don't forget what we have seen, and don't let it slip from mind. Let us make sure we remember what we've seen. Let us make sure we remember what's in our mind. Let us study it fastidiously, that we might be faithful and good followers. Be doers and not just hearers, okay? Let me make sure I listen, but not just listen, but then go and do whatever Jesus just said, okay? Bridle our tongues. Okay, you gotta work on that one. Okay, let us bridle our tongues. Let us think before we speak. Let us maybe not say it, even if it was justified. Just because it's right doesn't mean it's good. Or Jesus confronted false religion, and there's all sorts of things that we can do. We need to take these really to heart and strive and strive and strive to be the good Christians we're supposed to be and earn God's favor by doing good things. Yes? That's been known to happen in the faith over the years. I commend these texts to you and to me. We should look at them. But I'm not going to pour a bunch of lettuce on you right now. I'm not going to shoot all over you this morning. I want to go a different way. I taught high school for a while, so you know this. And one of the things about teaching that I've learned is there's different styles of learning. I mean, this, but I learned this a lot in my teacher training. One of the ways is you speak something to hear and you take it in that way. Another one is you read it, or it's in writing, and you process the writing. Those are kind of the standard ones. And if you go to seminary, that's about all you encounter. They're going to talk at you and make you read stuff and write stuff. And then they'll read stuff and write stuff back to you, and that's the transmission. You know, there are people of the Word, right? So things that focus on the Word make some sense. But there are a lot of other ways to learn, too. There's kinesthetic learners. Some people have to get up and walk and move in order to learn. They need to have their body moving along to process what's going on. That's one of the reasons the prayer labyrinths are so sitting still for 60 minutes isn't the kingdom of God come under this earth. Right? For some of us, we need to move. For some of us, it needs to be visual. You know, you guys don't get to do this. I can look back at that tapestry that was mimicked from what was at the youth gathering in Atlanta all the time. I love that tapestry. I love drinking in the visuals. You know, you should almost turn your seats away and not look at me and look at that while I preach. It won't hurt my feelings too much. But we, some of us learn by visual. We've got to find ways to communicate in ways that people pick up information. That's what good teachers do. They don't just talk about it. They don't just hand you a worksheet or a word search and sit down behind the desk and wait for you to get it done. They find ways to engage you in ways that are engaging. So let's listen to James. Let's be more than hearers only. Let's find other ways to learn. Let's find ways to see and to walk and to experience and to engage one another. Whatever the ways are that work for you and for people around you, let's engage the faith that way. I guess I was glad to start. I snuck the salad in. But James says, don't just be hearers, but when something comes to you of God, do something with it. Take it in. So if you're a oral learner, by all means, listen, take in the thing. But then let that sermon or that message or that devotion speak in you so that when you go out into the world, it comes out in a different way. A way that can be helpful to people. If you're a visual artist, if you love visual, great, drink it in. But find a way to share it. Send someone a postcard. Let someone else see it. Make something. Find a way to share that visual. Don't just take it in yourself. Don't just be a seer only. Be a seer and a doer. If you're an olfactory learner, I don't even know what that means. It's learning by smell. And incense communicates God to you. Go give someone some incense and smell it with them. You know what I'm saying? However it is that the faith comes to us, let's do that. It's a God-given gift. But let's take it and then go engage someone else with it as well. Don't keep the good news towards ourselves. When we say, let your light so shine before others. Think about that in the ways that it speaks to you. If music speaks to you, let your song so shine before others, that they might hear your good words and your music and glorify your Father in heaven. Right? If you're a visual artist, let your drawings, your paintings, your sculptures, your banners, your tapestries, your weavings, whatever it is you do, let those things so shine of your faith that others might see them and glorify your Father in heaven. You catch what I'm laying down? I got so mad at seminary that they only talked in certain ways. And those were my best ways of learning, but that's not the point. Because what happens is the people who go to seminary, if they don't learn that way, they get bounced out of seminary, and all the pastors come talking out, all the professors talk, and you lose people, and the seminary people sometimes get disconnected from the world. I promise you this is true, this happens. Let me give you an example. I had Terry Fredheim, who's a brilliant Old Testament scholar, doing prophets and those kind of classes, Old Testament stuff. Brilliant, it was great to drink from him. We were doing Jonah, talking about Jonah, and I went up to him and I said, what do you think of the VeggieTales Jonah? And he said, what's VeggieTales? And I hung my head, and I'm not going to call you out if you know VeggieTales. What it is computer-generated vegetables, bobs of fruit, let's make a cake. Animated vegetables, carrots, potatoes, scallions, whatever. And they do Sunday morning TV. They used to say it was Saturday morning TV with Sunday morning values. And they try to layer a little bit of scripture, and it's engaging, and a lot of people like them. They're not always great. It's no David and Goliath, for those of you who know back in the day and stuff. But it's all right. It's good stuff. But I was just curious what this very heady, well-read, well-spoken professor thought of computer-animated vegetables spouting scripture, and he hadn't even thought of it. So, of course, I went back and gave it to him and said, you should watch this and tell me what you think. Sometimes faith and devotion and seminary forgets to engage the world where they're at, which is sometimes computer-animated vegetables with Sunday morning values on Saturday morning. Here's another big disconnect we had. So, I really wanted to see this VeggieTales Jonah when it came out. I like VeggieTales. In fact, I have 150 songs on my phone right now. If you don't know who VeggieTales are, I will delight you later. But so, I was in Aberdeen, South Dakota. You know, I'm a cinephile. They had one theater in Aberdeen, South Dakota. was a funeral. We didn't know about it. And so we just had the kids walk to the side of the chapel, their emotions, and left. You know, I didn't notice, but apparently there was no one coughing up front, and she coughed and in his face instead of him, which greatly traumatized her kid. And so she wanted to chew me up and down about how awful this was and what kind of church we were. And I just thought, it's like, oh, what a disconnect. That church is supposed to be out of fun or whatever, and don't you dare get death in the middle of church. Don't start. What a disconnect. Don't you think? The world's steeped in death. Isn't that why Jesus came in? Jesus endured death for us. Jesus healed people who were dead. Jesus promises us that even though we'll die, it's not going to be the end of us. And the church is all about interacting with death, but not for this lady. What a disconnect. Sometimes faith and devotion and the seminary doesn't do a very good job of engaging the world around us with these things. But here's what I did. Rather than get mad at her, which I could easily done, I meant to snub me. That would have helped. I decided I'm not going to let my kid grow up that way. I'm not going to let my kid get to 12 or 13 or 14 and have no concept of death or dead bodies or any of that. And it just so happened, coincidentally, a couple weeks later, Helen died. Helen and Floyd were the local couple. Floyd owned the mortuary. And everyone knew that they'd been in the mortuary business since forever. And they also showed up at church on Wednesday before church school. And when the kids came from school, the buses would pick them up and drop them off. And Helen and Floyd knew every kid by name. Hey, Bobby, how's it going? Here's your Purell. Hope you're having a good day. How's your settlement? You're doing whatever. And they just knew every kid. Upwards, backwards, forward. Well, Helen died. And so it's time for her funeral. And I decided I was going to take Caleb with me. Caleb was maybe 2.5, 3 at that time. I said, I'm not going to have my kid grow up like that other kid. He's never traumatized. And so I brought Caleb, and I told Caleb, we're at the coffin looking out, and Caleb says, that's my friend Helen. I said, yep. And then Caleb said, but that's not really Helen anymore. It's like, you get it. You get it enough for today. For the next couple weeks, every once in a while, I hear from the back seat, I miss my friend Helen. It's like, I do too. But Caleb got it. We as a church should be able to engage in people's pains and brokenness and death and sin in real ways and acknowledge it and speak to it and make a place for people to grieve. So, that was my learning from all that veggie tale stuff. Just thought I'd share that with you. One of the things we hold to is that God is in the world. So wherever we go, we can encounter God, and God will go in there with us. That's a good thing, and that's a deep promise. But let's not get silly and say, well, God's in my piece of beef jerky word. Just because God's out about the world doesn't mean everything's equally holy. We have promises that God will lead us most reliably in word and in scripture. Right? That's Jesus. Jesus comes into the world. Jesus is the word. He comes in and speaks God's truth. We would do well to be hearers of God's word, to listen to Jesus, and not just be hearers, but be doers also. We would do well to watch him and see what he does and replicate his actions. Let's not get silly about this. But let's not write off the world and say God isn't out there in people's pain and brokenness, even their misunderstandings about funerals or veggie tales or whatever. God is there for sure. And God is reliably with us in the sacraments, which is why in a little bit we will have communion. Jesus told us we should. We believe that Jesus is present in the bread and the wine, and we believe it's a means of God's grace, so we will do it. We do that every week. We don't do baptisms every week. We don't have enough people to get baptized right now. But next week, you should be here, because Ellen Goldberg will be here, and she will be baptized. And I want you all to be here with us, standing up and making promises on behalf of God and God's community, and celebrating with Garrett and with Ashley and with your sponsors. I hope you can come and join us. Let's have a prayer. Dear God, we thank you that you love us, that you never leave us forsaken. There are things we could do and should do, and there's salad shooters poking at us all the time. God, beyond all that is your grace and your love. Help us to be in this world with authenticity. Help us carry and learn the faith with authenticity. Help people see in us some glimmer of you. Help us point away from ourselves towards you, like John the Baptist did. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Please rise and confess our faith in the word of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He has
your hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
If I can just share peace with those around you in that statement, it's
simple. I did it.
There we go. Every answer,
that's peace to you.
My son got a degree. He's going to be a teacher in Milton. He's over by Rockford. Teaching at the board.
Awesome to see you too.
Something to do with a heart. Something with a heart after.
And something about Tracy or something.
Yeah.
She might have a
home put in. She's in somewhere in Massachusetts.
Oh, I see that.
Hearts full of memories and hopes, you bring this to
are the bread within us. You are our heart's desire. You are our priceless treasure. You are the garden of paradise. Come down, O love divine. Come among us, O passionate fire. Come within us, O spirit of unity. Come, Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Bless us, O Lord, and these your gifts, which we have received from your bounty. Bless our table and the feast we share. Bless us with gladness of heart. Come, Holy Spirit. At this table, make us your body. Form us to be people of justice and peace. Fill us with gratitude and generosity, that we may bear the fruit of love in word and deed. Come, Holy Spirit.
Come, Holy Spirit.
Praise to you, author of creation. Praise to you, O beloved one. Praise to you, O giver of all good things. Praise to you, blessed and holy Trinity, one God, now and forever. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
We have tasted and we have seen that the Lord is good. You might have noticed we've got a TV that was donated to the church. We're starting to make use of it.
if you have things that you want to share, if you have pictures of people out and about, we have a picture of Paul Adamson from Costas this week from a Tanglewood, stuff going on that you want to share, people doing stuff, we're glad to put those up there. Announcements, a few things going on, you'd like, you can send them to me or to Joanne, and we'll fold them into those announcements. We want to make use of the technology, because not everyone learns best by hearing. We talked about that in the sermon. It's helpful sometimes to have stuff on pictures, it's helpful to have slideshows, it's helpful to have other ways to communicate, so I don't know about that. I wanted to let you know about Don Bloom. Some of you know him. We're part of the New Hampshire Conference of the New England Synod, and so the pastors get together, and they kind of keep us under control, because pastors can be a little unruly. They appoint someone as dean. Don Bloom has been dean for 22 years. That's longer than I've been a pastor, and I've been at this for a while. He has announced that he's resigning that position. If you want to offer a word of thanks to the church, you can get a note to me, and we can put something together. He's been a good and faithful servant. If you want the exemplar of all the good and faithful servant, you go look at Don Bloom and what he's done for us. So if you want to be a part of that, please do let me know. The Calumet Walk 2021 is almost done. That ends this Tuesday. It looks like the whole group is going to hit the 200,000 miles easily, which is going to release a whole bunch of donations. So thank you everyone who's been a part of that. They had a designated one day of giving that was last week that kind of sputtered a bit. I'm going to take it off the webpage later today, but if you want to help out that sputtering one day of giving, you got one chance. Hop on the page today and contribute to the GoFundMe. No obligations, no information. But what we're doing is generating funds so that people can keep on the can value that for year after year after year. But if you've been here there, you know what a great ministry that is. It's going to be supportive of that. For God's Work in Our Hands, which is September 12th, is the official day of this year, we're collecting school supplies for Family Promise of Southern New Hampshire. If you look at the display or up today, you can see the list of what we're looking for, what they're looking for. So far, we've collected over $800 worth of stuff. Partly we can leverage some private money with another students and stuff. But anyway, we have like $800 worth of school supplies going to Family Promise. But anything we can get them is good to get those kicked off to a good start for the school year. If you'd like to help, you just put on that paper wise and kind of call. We'll make sure it gets there for them and get the camera for the kids. I think those are my announcements. Does anyone have any other announcements this morning? Please come on down.
There's a great need. When people come across the border, they might be coming from we, as people of justice and people of faith, are considering this. So thank you.
Thank you. I would add to that, too, at the end of our reading from James, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress. To make a connection there. And to keep oneself unstained by the Lord. We're glad you're here tonight. If you'd like to keep lingering, Trudy's got some snacks out on the, what do we call that? The portico? I don't know what our name for that is. The
portico.
Portico. If you go to the portico, you will find some snacks and coffee and whatnot. Thank you for being here today. Please rise and receive a blessing. God, the source of glory. God, the word of life. God, the spirit of truth, bless you all.